Good morning. My name is Martin, and this is a tribe of the fox. Now, some deities, gods or goddesses, we know quite a lot about them because many of their mythology, their lore, is being preserved. And examples of those deities are, for instance, Odin, Loki, Freya, or Vrouw Holle. However, there are also many deities that we only know their name and not much more. Sometimes we just know their names because some altar or some votive stone has been found or excavated. And especially here in Northwestern Europe, we find quite a number of deities that are fairly unknown. So the tribe of the fox, so that is Dirkje and me, we are very interested in those deities because we are interested in the pre-Christian spirituality of Northwestern Europe. So, have you ever heard about a goddess named Aufania? Aufania. Most likely you have not heard about her, I think. And there are also not too much people who actually try to contact her. Fairly unknown goddess. So, what do we know about Aufania? First things first. This is a book that I already showed you before when I made a video about the triple goddess, the Matrone. So the Matrone, these triple goddesses, they were very, very important in pre-Christian Northwest Europe. And one of these triple goddesses was named, because they're known under many names, Aufania. Okay, so this book, of course, is not source material, but it talks about source material. It is written by Annine van der Meer, and she is a historian. And it's quite amazing, the book is not very thick, but there's a lot of useful information in it, and it reads really easy. So, if you're able to read Dutch, because I don't think it's translated in any other language, if you're able to read Dutch, I can really recommend you the books of Annine van der Meer. Very good books, I think, but that's just my opinion, you have to find it out for yourself. Now, what can we read in this book about Aufania? Well, we know her because of the altars, the votive stones that has been found. So we are talking here about only 70 altars. Only 70. 36 of them have been found in the city of Bonn. So Bonn is a city in the west of Germany. And later these altars were brought to the cathedral of Bonn, and that's where the researchers found them. Okay, well, interesting thing is, and by the way, not just Bonn, but also Nettersheim in Germany. That's also a hot spot of Aufania worship. And of course, what we don't know is how in the rural areas in the country, how she was worshipped. Yeah, because if you look here, then you see that this altar is very Roman in style, right? It's very Roman in style. These altars were made between 164 and 223 Common Era. But there's something interesting. This is not necessarily or not originally a Roman practice, because this area here in Northwestern Europe was basically the border between the Celtic world and the Germanic world. And the Romans, they came later and they adopted, not all the Romans, but some of them adopted Aufania worship. And we can see here that they are actually indigenous. She's an indigenous goddess because look at the heads that the two ladies on the side wear. So the one in the middle doesn't wear a hat because that's Aufania in her maiden form. And on the left and the right, you see Aufania in the mother and the grandmother form, and they wear this big balloon-shaped hats. Now, this big balloon-shaped hats, they belong to a tribe named Ubi. So that Lady Aufania is depicted with a headgear from the Ubi, that already says that this is an indigenous practice and is not originally a Roman practice. Now, interestingly enough, the Romans who worshipped her, they belonged to a legion, so they were military. And they brought Aufania to the city of Bonn. And that's also where a lot of these altar stones, these votive stones, these altars were donated by people who worshipped Aufania. Yeah, an interesting thing about this Roman legion, it was called Minerva. It was the name of the legion. So you name your legion after a deity named Minerva, but you're going to worship Aufania. Okay, well, that's a choice of the Romans. Okay, so what does her name mean, Aufania? It most likely means something like a remote swamp. But it can also mean, well, there is a Dutch word named ven, V-E-N. A ven is basically a little, tiny little lake, a bit of a mixture between a swamp and a tiny little lake. Now, that's very important to take that into consideration, because what are little swamps or big swamps? Yeah. They're liminal. They are places between land and water. And many deities are very earthbound. Also Lady Aufania. So those are deities that connect all the worlds. You know, the underworld, our world, higher realms. So that's very liminal. So a swamp is a connection with the underworld, for instance. Yeah, that's why those were places of worship. Yeah, Lady Aufania, the Lady of the Swamp, but she's actually so much more. It's not just a swamp goddess, definitely not. It's really like an earth goddess. So here we move into the territory of shamanic journeying and trying to contact those deities. Now, I am very lucky because the Netherlands is basically one big swamp, especially the area where I live in the west. I live in the west of the Netherlands, that's between the North Sea and the rest of the land. So it's pretty soggy and wet here. Now, there are places where I like to go, where I can contact Lady Aufania easier. Because, let me tell you something here that's very important. It is important to go to the old pagan places. It's always important. However, spirituality is never static. It's dynamic, it evolves. So you can find very special places, probably near your home. You don't have to go very far. So I found a place, or two places actually, where I can easier contact with Aufania. However, it is not an easy deity to connect with. I'm just a human being and she is very, very big, to use a word. It's a very deep and mysterious deity. And some deities, they present themselves in a more or less human form, like Wodan or even Hela. Other deities not. Aufania is one of those deities that is not really, it doesn't really feel human, more difficult to connect with, not so communicative as some others. But what I found out with my intuition is that, first of all, it's very important how to connect with her. So I made a video about Galder. Now, Galder is the use of your voice in your spiritual practice. So I go to the place where I can connect with her the best way. And then I do my Galder, my singing, and I let it spontaneously arise. And it's very important you do Galder to tune into the energy of that particular deity. Now, in case of Aofania, it's important to use a deep voice, I found out. A deep voice and the right words. So you have to let that spontaneously, intuitively come up in you. And then you get into a different mood, different energy level, and then you can easier connect. Now, Aofania, when I found the right Galder, I could easier connect, but still on a very intuitive level, not on a talkative level. And I found out that she is very much an earth goddess. An earth goddess who gives life in this realm and takes life. So here we really have a triple goddess. So think about the Norns. You have Norns who are from the, sometimes it says from the past, the present, and the future. And we have the youngest one of the Norns who cut the string of life, the thread of life, that's the right word. And that reminded me quite a lot about Aofania. She can give life from the deepest of the earth, from the realm of the dead. She can also take life in a very natural way, because that's nature. Giving and taking, coming and going, always cyclic. Everything is cyclic. Everything comes, everything goes. But she's also a bit more unpersonal, so to speak. Not so willing to connect with people, it almost felt. Still, I was able to make contact with her. I felt she was also a bit more, in a certain way, a bit more of a darker goddess. A bit more darker. Because she was so unpersonal and also can take life. But I also strongly had the intuitive feeling that she plays a role when the cycle of our era that we live in, when that ends. And also the beginning of a new cycle. So she's a very powerful goddess. That's what I found out by shamanic journeying. And I appreciate her a lot. I like to go to the places where I can contact her easier and make offerings to her and do my Galder, my singing. So that's also an offering. So, this is a slightly shorter video than the videos I made recently, because there's not so much known about Aofania. And I really inspire you to have a closer look at deities that are not so well known. So that said, this is the end of the video, and I wish you all the best. Stay safe, stay healthy. See you in the next video. Bye.